Thank you very much, Davinda, and thanks to the organization that Mugambi and Mandombe dragged us into. You know, in the year 2004, we were very unhappy with CASA, because CASA had taken a position of laundering political corruption. And so we wanted to attack CASA from a fairly scientific position, because they were used to our method, which was political position. And they had been briefed by the then Attorney General Amos Wako how to deal with it. Because Amos Wako had told him that we were so bad in what we wrote that we didn't even edit them well. So what they would have needed to do is to get their people to get what we had written and sort of go through it scientifically and sort of mess it up. So we decided that we were going to review CASA. But we decided to review CASA from the margins. So our first target of review was the Kenya National Commission on Human Rights. So we decided that we were going to do an audit of the Kenya National Commission on Human Rights, at that time chaired by Maina Kiai, who of course was an ally. So we entered a deal with Maina that we're going to do this thing. So we prepared the tools, we prepared the process, and we started it. But when we finished, Maina didn't know we were as serious as we were, because the audit of the Kenya National Commission on Human Rights at that time revealed that they were doing good stuff, but there were a lot of areas in which they would have done better. We thought that at that time they had remained fairly a big government NGO, other than being a statutory institution. But in any case, they had done good work for us because that open space. And I must say that within that period of audit, the Kenya National Commission of Human Rights really moved its muscles further. And they moved beyond what we were doing as NGOs and started doing what we couldn't do in terms of raising key questions and in terms of formulating where we ought to go. So the idea, for example, of a human rights state got a new impetus in the work of Kenya National. But there was division within the Kenya National Commission on Human Rights about our audit at that time, as the Kenya Human Rights Commission. So what we told them to do was we told them to respond. So to date, I have a 21-page response authored by Mboro Gitu, who was at that time the secretary of the Kenya National. And they responded bullet by bullet on various matters we had raised. And our audit was framed in three major areas. One, we had raised a question on the question of a commission and its role in protecting the sovereignty of the people. And we had thought that they had done it, but they had not done it adequately. We had also raised the question of the extent to which they were promoting, they were promoting the drive then of the constitutional reform movement, and we thought that that ought to be something that they ought to have played more role in. And the third thing we had raised at that very stage was the issue of values. We had said that they ought to play more role in pushing us towards embracing, you know, better values and so on. So there was that response. Then with that strength, we agreed that launching that report would have been deleterious to the National Commission and the efforts that we were pursuing. So true to the three linguas, we chose the third one, silence. So we did not launch the report. However, we used that very acceptance of the National Commission to write to CASA. And we told them, the Kenya National Commission has agreed on an audit, we've done it, and here is evidence, a letter suggesting that they had accepted the audit. So now we want to audit you. And they accepted. They accepted that we should audit them. Unfortunately, when we were developing the tools, they discovered us. They discovered that you were up to no good in the sense that you were going to basically glare the lights on them, because they were the target. But what we learned from that process was that if you engage the commissions, you are able to sort of reframe them, and you are able to call them back to order, and you are able to sort of reposition them. It is with that history in mind that one of the areas that we have suggested as a committee to deal with in this audit of the Constitution is the Chapter 15 institutions. Tom, you are very excited. IFORA is not part of Chapter 15, but it does very good work. So, and I had very good discussions with Tom to develop the concept around this. And what we have in mind? We have in mind four major things. One, if you look at the core idea of our constitution, which Yash Palghai keeps reminding us is transformative constitution, we suppose to, among many other things, inclusivity and dignity, we suppose to sort of return the country back to the people and reinforce this framework of belonging and return us from being wananchi to being wenyenchi. And that objective is captured in chapter 15 is so generous, it only states three core objectives for the national commissions. Three. The first one is to protect sovereignty of the people. Second one is to promote national values. And third one is to basically promote the framework of constitutionalism. Three. Broad, but very generous. So we think that with that in mind, what we want to do is to pose questions like, how do we ensure that the Chapter 15 commissions become more of citizens' protectors in the sense of helping us as an insulator to the executive that has been growing its fangs again and it wants to mold us again. So that beyond the National Commission going with us for demonstrations, which is good, they do what they ought to do, which is what we can do. Which is beyond the Revenue Allocation Commission saying, look, we don't have enough resources, it's difficult to get a formula. They get a formula which will promote equity, which will promote social economic rights and other grounds of rights, for example. Which is, how do we ensure that, for example, the situation that the Revenue Allocation Commission found itself in, you know, some years back when they tried to hold the politicians accountable by capping both the ceilings in terms of salaries and allowances. Then the next thing was, let's remove them. So what do you do? But most important, we are targeting this time three other folks. The National Police Service Commission has to completely lost it. It's completely lost it. And we know. And we know that the vetting that they're doing, for example, is completely ridiculous. But beyond that, they have completely sold out their autonomy. Completely. Completely. This is not the National Police Service Commission that we yearned for. It's not. Completely. So they have become the secretariat of the IG. And they're good at that. The National Land Commission has not only lost it, but they have become chief priests in land grabbing, and they are completely doing nothing else but serving the modernist agenda of the Jubilee administration, which is big roads, SGR, to settle a few people here with a few titles. But the key question of land reforms is completely being negated and in fact is being reversed. And then, of course, you don't want to talk about the Kenya National Commission on Human Rights, and they're not here.
Yeah.
Oh, they're here. The Kenya National Commission on Human Rights is a very important institution and very close to us, as you said. And most of the commissioners there are personal friends. But if you ask them what they stand for now, they stammer. Why do they stammer? If you ask them what they stand for. If you ask them why there is no motion in various areas where we had made significant gains, they say, look, We have no money. But we need so much without money. You cannot, the mandate of the National Commission is not just to issue press releases, and that's it, that's the response. What did we do? We issued a press release. No. So the essence, therefore, in our opinion, of going back to the national commissions is to try and ensure that we are able to restore the spirit of transformative constitution that is so much at the center. And indeed, even questions of gender then falls within that ambit of the transformative agenda in the constitution. And the final point that I want to raise on that very question is that Parliament has done an audit of the constitution. The audit, which was done through the office of the Auditor General, was sponsored that time by Jubilee government. And they had thought that the verdict was going to be that devolution is expensive. Fortunately, I want to hope that most of you have seen the report, the verdict is that devolution is not expensive, which I think is very useful. But if you look at the criteria that they have used to do the audit again, it's fairly state-centric. Kauti Kanyinga, who was advising in the process, tried very, very much to expand the criteria of the audit, but sort of they refused and they retained it in the orbit of finances, in the audit of state interest, and in the audit of state protection. So we have to then try and make sure that we do something that has dialogue with sort of what has been done from a state-centric perspective. And that is why our model is useful. But where would that lead us? One last story. One great thing that I remember very well about Maina Kiai and the National Commission was that he said, look, we are an obligation to release a report every year. And this report is sent to Parliament. But we don't leave Parliament. Parliament is a representational institution, but sometimes and often it is not able to quite talk to what the citizens want. And you also say that our report is not just supposed to be, you know, for filing, but it's supposed to be to trigger conversation. So Maina Kiai suggested the framework of holding meetings at KICC between the commission and the citizens, a bunge kind of an encounter. And if you look at jurisdictions like Mexico, South Africa to some extent, but most of I like what I see in Bolivia, the human rights institutions have this culture of making sure they position themselves as the protector of citizens, such that the bunge sessions that they hold with the wananchi to get feedback and to read the spirit and the health of the nation is more important than the report they write to Parliament. In fact, the report they write to Parliament are informed by those encounters, which are honest encounters. Sometimes you criticize ruthlessly, sometimes you praise, but they're the most important elements and they constitute the real essence of national commissions or constitutional commissions as public protectors. And you know, in South Africa, it is because of a constitutional commission that today President Zuma is paying back the money that he used to build his home in Nkandla. How comes our commission here is not doing anything that sort of helps us to take back the citizens? For example, if you all know, if you see that road along State House, who is building a big house there which is equal to a hotel? And look at public resources being done on that road. Who should pay back the money used to expand that road? Because it's being expanded mainly to give access to his house. Who should raise this point? This is all of the national commissions. We will demonstrate, we will raise it, and we will do it like we've done now. But the National Commission should do something better than this.
Right.
So it is important there for us to do that return. So we think that the formula that we have used in the audit will not just be sort of a bit of scripting, but it will be fairly activist. What we used to call, and we still call, utafiti kereketwa. So the method of utafiti kereketwa will be very engaging, will be very ruthless, but we'll do it with the commissions as our allies, with the aim of sort of restoring them back to where they belong. Thank you.